might remember 21 years ago because it was right at the time when Finding Nemo was coming out. And great movie, kind of a fairy tale. And I myself was sort of living a fairy tale. I was married to a wonderful man, my husband Mark, who is a pediatrician and a very science-minded, data-driven kind of person. And I, okay, so if you can't prove something to Mark, doesn't exist, which is in stark contrast to my, I trust the universe and believe everything anyone ever tells me. So, but we make it work, and we had two boys at the time, Levi, who was three, and he confounded everyone because he spoke in full sentences and used words like flamingo and catastrophe. And then we had a four-month-old baby, Eli, who I'm pretty sure was the inspiration for Sheryl Crow's song, All I Want to Do Is Have Some Fun. And one day, Mark was playing with the baby on the carpet in the living room, and he looks at me and he says, you need to take the baby to a pediatric ophthalmologist. Okay, why? Because he can't see. And I was like, what? I felt like I just got sucker punched and all the wind got knocked out of me and I couldn't breathe. And then even worse, I was like engulfed by a tsunami of guilt. What kind of mother doesn't realize that her son can't see? And so I was like, I started to argue with Mark because I was in that denial stage of grief, and I was, but he watches television. He loves Big Bird. And my logical, reasonable husband said, he can distinguish light from dark, but he's not tracking. Okay, but like he looks right at me every time I call his name. Again, sweetheart, he can hear, and it's a natural reflex to turn towards sound. And just like that, my fairy tale ended. I take Eli to the pediatric ophthalmologist, who concurs with Mark and tells me, yes, my son is blind. He has a rare genetic condition that is permanent and incurable. I'm in shock. And the only thing I remember saying was, but I've never even met a blind person, which I'm really ashamed of saying now when I look back because it sounds so ignorant. Because I know blind people have wonderful lives and families and friends and loves and careers, but at that moment, I was so stunned and I just wanted my kid to have an easy life. And this did not sound like it was going to be a super easy life. She's talking this whole time about getting us an appointment with a pediatric neuro-ophthalmologist. There's only two in the country, but it's gonna take a couple of months, and it probably won't do anything anyway, but I have hope. So I say, yes, yes, please, make the appointment. We're driving home, and I hear a voice inside of myself, like that still small voice. No, this is not Eli's story. Ding, I look down, there's a voicemail from Mark's sister, Jackie, who I have to tell you is the like pragmatic doppelganger of my husband. And she's giving me contact information for a Jewish energy healing psychic. What? I mean, if you have to, this is so outside the realm of this woman's world. But it's a sign, I hear you, yes. So I call immediately. He picks up. It's Tevia from Fiddler on the Roof. I tell him about Eli and that he's blind and I need help. And he says, I will help your son see. Thank God. How much will it cost? Nothing. It's free. Maybe one day you'll make a donation. And I have to confess that, yes, was holding the baby, and he's, we're on the phone, it's telephonic healing. He's doing it, and so finally, we get to the final session, and it is actually the day before we're supposed to take Eli to this pediatric neuro-ophthalmologist guy, and Tevye says, there's one last thing we have to do. Okay? He tells me to hold Eli up to the mirror, which I do, and then he tells me to take out my imaginary scissors, which I do, and then he tells me to cut Eli's karmic cord, which I do. And when I'm done, he says, now your son will see. Okay, next day, we are in this pediatric neuro-ophthalmologist's office. I've got Eli on my lap. Doctor walks in, sits down, takes a look at Eli, reaches into his pocket and pulls out this little dinosaur toy, and he holds it up, and Eli looks at it, and he moves it, and Eli follows it, and then he moves it, and Eli follows it again. And then he looks at me and goes, I'm sorry, why are you here? because my baby can't see. Well, looks like he sees pretty well to me. And Mark and I are looking at each other like, what the hell just happened? We did not imagine, our baby can see. It truly was a miracle, and we were over the moon. We were laughing, we were crying, and we get in the car, we're driving home, and I cannot wait to tell Mark what I have done. So I noticed, though, that he's talking and talking and talking medical terms and whatever, and he's telling me about this very rare medical condition called delayed visual maturation, and very few babies, but some babies do have this. They're born blind, and then by 6 or 8 months, they spontaneously develop vision. And I'm laughing like, come on, Billy. That is totally not what happened. Tell him about Tevye.
Spent a lot of time talking. Sometimes we would share with each other secrets from our past. But the most fun we ever had was the time when I would ride her around the college campus on my bicycle, and she would be set side side saddle on the bar, and then I would ride very fast on the college sidewalks, and I loved the wind in my face and the feel of her body next to mine and the sound of her laughter. But summer came and we parted it. But we still connected with each other, we still wrote, and there were letters of great meaning and terrible longing. Well, fall came and we got back together and everything was wonderful again. But after several months, something very eerie happened. It was late afternoon, we were walking back to campus, and the sun was shining at our backs, and I could see our shadows elongated on the sidewalk in front of us. And it suddenly dawned on me that it looked like a father was walking with his daughter. You see, I was 6 feet tall, I still am, and she was 5'4". And it suddenly hit me that everyone else, we must have looked very strange. It was then that I started to have doubts in my mind. Well, it was my senior year, and I spent most of the time in the basement working on my honors project, and I felt like I was trapped in there. I mean, I just felt like everybody else was out there having a lot of fun, and I was stuck in here. And then, late spring, it was finally finished. And I felt such a sense of release, such a sense of freedom, such a sense of joy. Everything seemed new. And then it hit me that this was my time when I could find that elusive college co-ed with the long blonde hair and the beautiful face and the gorgeous legs. Well, then I decided that I should break up with Gesta. I knew it wasn't going to be easy. And she started wailing, and she started crying, and she started yelling at me and saying she would do anything in the world if I would just not leave her. So she threw herself down on the ground on her knees, and she wrapped her arms around one of my legs, as if to keep me from walking out the door. And I felt repulsed. I felt terribly embarrassed. Well, I found McGlon. And Desta, after a few years, got married to one of my friends. But the blonde faded, and Desta eventually got her divorce. For the last 57 years, she's been on my mind a lot. I've been back to visit her in Chicago twice. I called her on the phone a lot of times. We still had that great rapport together, but she had adopted two kids that had ADS. She had a terrible time raising them.
was the summer of 1971, Tempe, Arizona. I'm a high school kid, working various odd jobs to keep gas in my tank and a little extra weekend money in my pocket. I get a phone call. It's Mrs. Schmidt from the end of the cul-de-sac across the street. Wants to hire me to water her yard plants and check her pool chemicals while they go on vacation for a couple of weeks. Easy money. I accept the gig. About a week in, I get a call. It's Mrs. Schmidt. She says someone had called her to complain that there had been wild parties going on in her backyard. For multiple nights in a row, teenagers drinking, playing loud music, jumping in the pool. She says to me, "You're not to be doing that." I said, no, I'm not. I'm doing what you hired me to do, water the plants, check the pool. She said, we'll be back next week, click. All right, I was no angel in those days, but this was a totally bum rap. I mean, I was being blamed for something I didn't do. And I was determined to get to the bottom of it. So I called in some backup. My buddy Randy from down the street. We waited until after dark, about 9 p.m., and we went over to the Schmidt's. I reached over the gate at the front side of the house, unlatched it, we opened it, walked into the backyard, all quiet. I shut the gate, and then I proceeded to implement my surveillance plan. We disrobed down to our undershirts, stashed our clothes, we went to the pool, got in, and sat on the steps at the shallow end with nothing but our heads out of the water. See, that way, we could observe the whole backyard, and if anybody tried to come or go, they wouldn't immediately even recognize that we were there. Brilliant. So we sit there, chin high in the water for about 10 minutes, when Randy says, "Hey, you left the gate open." I said, no, I shut the gate when we came in. I latched it, I remember. He said, "I look, there it is, the gate, wide open." So we slip out of the pool, we make it to the gate, we look around, nobody, nothing. And then out of the corner of my eye, in the Arcadia door on the patio, I see the curtains move slightly. I think to myself, did I just see that? So I whispered to Randy, "Be cool." Let's go. So we gather our clothes, we go out front. I said, "Just walk to my house." So on the way, I'm telling him, "Here's the plan. I think there's somebody in there. So we're gonna go, we're gonna make like we're saying goodbye. You head toward your house, I'll go inside, but you double back, go down around the alley to the back of the Schmidt's house. I'll wait inside for 5 minutes, and when nobody's expecting, I'll come back out, go through the front gate, I'll meet you in the backyard, and if anybody's there, we will nap them." All right? So, I go inside, I wait 5 minutes. I come out, I'm just about to head to the Schmidt's house, when here's Randy. And he says, "Hey, how'd you get back over here so fast?" I said, what do you mean? I was just on my way over to see you." He said, no, you were just in the backyard." And I said, no, I've been here. I was just on my way." He said, "But no, I saw you. I saw you in the backyard. You were there. It was your clothes, your hair, your face. It was you. I saw you. And you had a bucket in your right hand." I said, well, what happened?" He said, you walked to the pool and you filled the bucket with pool water. And I called out to you, and you looked right at me, and then turned around and scurried off around the far corner of the house with a bucket of water." Well, something weird is going on in McAllister Avenue. So we head back over to the Schmidt's. Randy waits out front while I go into the backyard. All quiet, go to the pool. I retrace the steps Randy said he saw me take with the bucket, because surely, come on, if somebody had scurried away with a full bucket of water, there, some would have splashed out. Nothing but dry ground. So I go back out front and I rejoin Randy in the driveway. And we're standing there puzzling about what just occurred when Randy's eyes get wide. He says, the front curtains just moved. I'm getting out of here. And he takes off down the street, runs back to his house, leaves me standing there all alone. And I'm telling you, I got this feeling that somebody was watching me. And then I look at it like, did I see those curtains move? Whoa, I'm telling you, I was a ballsy kid back then, but this is something I decided I did not want to get to the bottom of. So I just hightailed it back to the safety of my own home. And I thought, who should I tell? Who should I report? Should I report this? I mean, who would believe this? So I told no one. I just kept going over there, watering the plants. In the light of day, mind you, I would not go there after sunset. So the following week, I get a call. It's Mrs. Schmidt. Hi. We're home. Come on over. We'd like to pay you. No way. I'm not going back to that place, let alone inside that place. I mean, not only because of what I experienced, but I knew that the Schmidt suspected me of something. I mean, maybe they were trying to lure me in there where they'd hold me captive and interrogate me. Or maybe I stumbled upon something that they didn't want me or anybody else to know about. So I said, thanks, but no charge.
I am a self-diagnosed and therapist diagnosed people pleaser. I care a lot about what people think of me. I also have what I have deemed the trifecta of insecurity. First, I'm an overthinker. Works out really well for me as an accountant. Not so well for me when I'm thinking about a conversation I had 3 weeks ago and, oh my gosh, did I say the wrong thing? They hate me now. Secondly, I have trouble taking up space. Again, I do okay on stage playing a character. Not so good in the produce section when I'm standing in front of the lemons and now someone needs a lemon and I have to apologize profusely because I am blocking the lemon. So then I rush over to the bananas and I just pray they don't need a banana because then I'm going to have to apologize again. And last but not least, I rely a lot on external validation. Let's just say I didn't have to take the 5 love languages quiz. Words of affirmation was already just like flashing bright lights at me. That is actually what led me to falling in love for the first time 3 years ago. I had loved people before, but never been in love because accountant, logical, feelings, what? No, I don't do that. And this person said all the things that I needed to hear, and I loved him, and we talked about a future, and we were gonna get an apartment in Scottsdale and drink peppermint tea on the balcony at night, and he used me and discarded me, and I had my heart broken. So at this point, I'm grieving, and I luckily have my best friend, Sarah Ruth, who knows when I'm sad, I don't really eat, so she sends me pizza. And I'm crying, like, a lot. And again, feelings, no, I don't like this. I'm just crying, and it's affecting work, and it's affecting other things I have going on, so Finally, I'm able to transition to the next phase of grief. Set up a Tinder profile and find a distraction. So, in yesterday's yoga pants and hair I haven't washed in more days than I'd like. cheeks. I pull out my phone and start looking for the happiest, goofiest pictures of myself to put together just a glowing profile. And when it's all set up, I start swiping, and I come on Anthony's profile. He has dark hair, dark eyes, tan skin, a muscular build that I don't mind looking at, and a very warm, welcoming smile. So I take a deep breath, and I swipe right. Oh, I did it. Quicker than I was ready for, I get a notification that we matched. And I'm like, oh no, I have to do this now. So, but luckily, the witty banter quickly ensues. I find out he is also a nerd. He's an IT auditor, and he works from home. He jokes that if he had to go into the office, he would strangle his coworkers. And honestly, I know the feeling. We bond over a mutual love of margaritas and tacos, and he tells me that his hobby is Brazilian jiu-jitsu. He cheekily asks me if I prefer being choked or hugged, and I say, you're gonna owe me a couple margaritas before I answer that question. This whole time I'm texting screenshots to Sarah Ruth, you know, showing her our conversation and his profile and making sure, you know, I get the stamp of approval from the best friend. She gives me the green light, and Anthony and I set up a date for Saturday. We're gonna go to Cocina Madrigal down in South Phoenix. So I'm getting ready, and of course my face is broken out and I'm not feeling super confident. I'm like putting makeup on, but of course I haven't gone to the store and my makeup is the wrong shade, so now my face is a different color than my neck, and oh my gosh, he's gonna notice this and he's gonna think I'm catfishing him. So I'm like trying to make my hair and my outfit look good, because maybe if those look good, he won't actually see my face. And I get a notification from him as I'm freaking out, and he offers to pick me up on the way to dinner. He's living in North Phoenix, I'm living in Central Phoenix, and dinner is in South Phoenix, so it would have been on his way, but maybe I just watched too much Dateline, but I just don't feel super comfortable being picked up on the first date, although the people pleaser in me is like, you must say yes, but I'm like, it'll be okay, and I let him know, like, hey, sorry, just like to play safe on the first date, I'll meet you there. And luckily, he just laughs it off. He's like, oh yeah, I knew you were gonna see that I was on the FBI Most Wanted list. And I'm like, phew, okay, he's not mad at me, this is good. I show up at Cucina Madrigal, step out into this sort of dusty gravel parking lot, trying not to get it all over my shoes, and I look up, and there he is, and we smile, and we hug, and I feel his muscular arms around me and smell his cologne, and we walk into the restaurant, only to immediately walk out because there is a 2.5 hour wait. So, plan B, we whip out our phones and we decide, Taco Boys in Central Phoenix. Okay, this is the plan. Again, he offers me a ride, but accountant, unlogical. Right now, we're in South Phoenix. Taco Boys is in Central Phoenix. If we go together to Central Phoenix, now he's going to have to take me back to my car in South Phoenix, and then I'm going to have to drive home back to Central Phoenix, and he's going to have to drive home to North Phoenix, and I'm just like, there's a lot of driving going on here and emissions. Let's just drive separately. Okay. So, drive up to Taco Boys, and apparently I did not get the memo, but everyone wants tacos today. There is no parking at Taco Boys, so I text Anthony really quick, like, sorry, no parking. And now I'm on the side streets of South Phoenix trying to look for a spot that's twice the size of a normal spot to parallel, because I can't parallel. So that takes me a little bit. Finally find a spot to park, and I just text him apologizing profusely because, of course, it's my fault that everyone in Phoenix wants tacos today. And I say, I'm so sorry. Here's plan C. Send. about workplace violence and choking me and being on the FBI most wanted list. And maybe these were totally jokes. And so I'm starting to think that maybe I dodged a bullet. My takeaway from this whole thing is just a sort of funny first date anecdote that I can tell people. I wasn't super heartbroken about it. I did crunch the numbers and determine that I am still 95% a people pleaser, but the 5% of the time when I stick to my guns and trust my gut, it's probably the right way to go.
Came to work at our company as an administrative assistant, and she started asking me if I could help her with this and teach her how to do that. And being Minnesota nice, I said, sure, why not? And her name is Junko, and she and I got to be pretty good friends. And we became workout buddies. She spent Thanksgiving with us at our house. And you know, we spent a lot of time getting to know each other and talking about life in general. Well, after she'd been with the company for about 3 years, she decided she wanted a change of scenery and she wanted to move to California. And she asked me if I'd be a job reference for her. Of course, sure, I'd love to. So I gave her a glowing reference and told how fast she had learned the rules of the company and how well she had been integral to our team, and you know that they were really lucky to get her. So, you know, we kept in touch a little bit by texting, but not much. 18 years later, I get a Facebook request from Junko, ask if I'd be a reference for a job in Seattle. So I'm thinking, okay, 18 years. I haven't worked with you for 18 years. I liked you when I knew you, but what have you been doing? So I work on a computer, and the easiest way to find something is to look it up. So I researched her. So I went on her Facebook page, and looked and saw what she'd been doing. I knew she lived in Japan for a little while, but she didn't have many Facebook friends. And then I went, well, LinkedIn, what's she been doing for jobs? Went and looked out there, and she could have had a few jobs here and there, but they were pretty scattered and didn't have like a lot of time at any one job. Okay, didn't even have an Instagram account. I Googled her and didn't really find much. So now I'm like, so I just asked her, what have you been doing? And she gave me some kind of answer about, oh, well, I spent some time in Japan with my family, and now I'm back in the States, and I thought maybe you could help me out. And I'm like, I'm still kind of unsure. I wanted to be nice and, you know, help her out if I could. until she said the reason she didn't have many Facebook friends or many friends from her past was that she had become quite skilled at ghosting people if they required too much effort or energy to be friends of hers. And I'm like, excuse me? My Minnesota nice just gasped in horror. You're telling me that you ghost somebody? It's one of the most cruelest things you can do. You know, you spend all this time invested in getting to know these people and get them to trust you, and you trust them and become friends and coworkers, and you just walk away from that because it takes too much effort? No, that's not what you do. I was extremely angry and disappointed in hearing this from Junko, and I told her, I said, I can't be a reference for you because I can't trust that you're actually going to come through with this job, and what a bad reflection on me as a reference if you don't do what you're hired to do. And so I told her I wished you well in her life in Seattle, and that, you know, but we were done. We were no longer friends. And I was really disappointed, and I lamented that I was losing a friend. Friendships mean a lot to me, you can tell. And it changed the way that I was raised in Minnesota to become a friend of somebody, to learn to trust them, to spend the time with them. I've gotten a little bit more cautious about putting my faith in somebody without getting to know them really, really well. I become a little bit more introverted, and I don't let myself be out there for anybody who needs anything as much because I don't want to get hurt. But the thing is, if I do trust you and I do become your friend, I will still feed your snake.
Phoenix, Arizona, packed up our car with the three kids and two dogs, and I'm a pharmacist. I'm managing a pharmacy that's within a grocery store in the middle of town, and it's in a poor area. A lot of blue-collar workers, a lot of people on access. It's Arizona's kind of name for Medicare programs and what have you, and I really think that my patients have come to love me, because you see, I'm the guy in the white coat, hopefully with a sense of humor and a smile, that gets to know their names, that really does care about them, and I'm easy access. I'm free. Walk on in, ask me a question, I can help you. And I really love it. I start to think of this pharmacy kind of as mine, though Fries would argue with that. And I treat it as though it's my own personal Cheers without the liquor but with drugs. I'm kind of a hybrid of Sam and Woody. And I love it back there. I love being this. And I wonder if this is just my nature, or if this is the nurture from my parents. But in the end, I really think it was my way of learning how to deal with my past, with my historic past. You see, my mother was a Holocaust survivor. She lived in Graz, Austria. Schwarzenegger is from there, by the way. Until she was 12 years old, when her family was killed by the Nazis. She escaped, obviously made it here. Here I am. But her parents, my grandparents, Abe and Helena, were people that lived in the back and black and white of the photographs, that the few that she still had, and the stories that she told. And I will tell you that growing up, the ghosts of those stories, their memories, the things that I had slowly learned had happened to them, were things that a young person's nightmares can be built out of. But as I got older, fortunately, I figured out how to deal with the fear and the anger and all that came with history like that. I decided that for their sake and to deal with this, number one, I promised to never forget. But number two, I was going to live a life that they would want me to live. I was going to be a good person. I was going to be a mensch. I was going to be a Dudley Do-Right, not a Snidely Whiplash. That's the whole idea. So, we're in the pharmacy. It's a late afternoon, and it's busy as hell. It's about 4 o'clock. That's when everything really starts to click. And there's a cacophony of sounds. The phones are ringing. People are in a line at the window. We only had one window at the time. The loudspeakers are going. There's buzzing from the fluorescent lights above me. It's warm. And there's a lot going on that I have to take care of because it's really not a bar. I can't make a mistake. And I'm watching everything. I've got one pharmacist with me. I have two techs with me. I'm in the middle of the pharmacy. I'm typing on my computer. I've got one phone with a cord under my ear like this. And I'm working away, and I keep an eye on the baskets that are going. And then suddenly I hear, hey, Alan! Just from the sound, I know who it is. It's Bill. Now, Bill is this kind of shorter, gruffy southern guy whose entire multi-generational family I've been taking care of for a couple of years. So I know it, and he's up at the middle of the glass, the little piece of plexiglass that separates the vitamins from the pharmacy, and other people are looking at him, they're in line, and he's interrupting me, and he holds up a vial, and he says, Alan, can you lend me a couple of pills just to get me through the weekend? So I can come in and pick him up when the doctor okays it and when I can get paid. Oh. I know his profile, and I know there's nothing that would be in his chart that I would have to worry about being a controlled substance. I go, Bill, no problem. I said, just hand me the vial. And Bill reaches over with the vial, reaches up. I'm up on a platform like this, and I'm reaching down, and as he reaches the vial up to me, his long-sleeved cotton shirt starts to crawl its way up. Oh. I lose my breath. I don't know how I've never noticed it before, but there he has a tattoo, and I suddenly can't breathe. I feel the actual ghosts of my grandparents screaming from my bones. I feel a rush of adrenaline. I get shaky. My heart rate goes up. I get sweaty. My back hurts. And all of the things that I'm in charge of and all of the sounds going on all fall away to nothing. Kind of like when you're in a traffic accident and things come to a very slow crawl. I think 10 minutes passed, it was probably 10 seconds, that I shake myself out of this. And I go, Bill, just go sit with the other people. I'll take care of you in a minute. And it was kind of gruff for me because that's not the normal way I talk to people. And I look at the pharmacist to my side and I say, take over, I can't work right now. And I go in the back of the pharmacy and I start to pace a little bit, thinking about, okay, calm down. And how are you going to handle this? Because I'm still hearing my grandparents screaming. I took a couple of the correct pills, put them in the vial, walked outside the pharmacy, and I approached Bill, who's sitting with other people that are waiting for things. And it had to be obvious that I was approaching him in a rather harsh style. And he's looking at me, and I think he sees something's not right. And I walk up to him, not caring who's around me, and I go, Bill, here's a couple days to get you through, but I want you to know that I'm doing this for two reasons. One, I'm a pharmacist, I'm your family's healthcare professional. But way more than that, I want you to know I'm doing it because I'm a Jew. And I will tell you something. When I saw that tattoo of that goddamn fucking swastika on your arm, I was made sick. That's a symbol of the people that murdered my grandparents, my mother's family, and 6 million other Jews that didn't deserve it at all, along with many others. And if I ever have to look at that again, you'd better not come in this pharmacy or this grocery store. Now there's dead silence. I'm looking at Bill. Bill's looking up at me. Everybody's suddenly quiet, including my staff. All of a sudden, I start to see Bill start to choke up. And he starts to tear. And he says to me, Alan, never in my life would I hurt you intentionally. When I was younger, in Arkansas, I was in a bar with the wrong people, and I got into a bar fight that I lost badly. I woke up the next day. I was black and blue. I was missing this tooth, and I had this stupid thing on my arm. He said, now look, I've learned people don't like it. But I had no idea until right now exactly what this was the symbol of and how it can hurt people like that. I said, Bill, let's go over to the side. We walked away from the pharmacy. And we talked for what seemed like 10 minutes, and I think this time it really was 10 minutes. I went home that night and told my wife, Amy, the story, and we came up with a decision as to how to best deal with this. It wasn't Monday. The doctor didn't get back to us till Tuesday when I called Bill in to pick up his prescription. And I said to him, I said, Bill, so over the weekend, my wife and I were able to locate a doctor that's willing to remove the tattoo from your arm. We will happily cover the payment. It'll take about 3 different processes to go through. Bill thanked me. It did take about 3 weeks. The tattoo was removed to never incite the ghosts of the Holocaust, at least, once again. I will tell you, now I'm 73, married 50 years, still have hair, and since that time, I've housed a lot of other ghosts that have passed on in my life, and I keep a good relationship and a loving relationship with all of them. But that said, I make sure that I keep my promise of never forgetting, and I keep my promise of constantly working to be a good person to my grandparents, Elena and Abe, of blessed memory. Thank you so much.
Great way of sharing your life with people. This is a wonderful theater space. You're lucky.